Hello guys and welcome to another exciting video on this channel. In this video I'll be going through the very basics of Affinity Designer. So this will be kind of like a getting started tutorial for newbies who are kind of new to designing. Maybe they are on t-shirts, maybe they are just entering into the field of design and they just want to get familiar with this software. So this will be a very basics tutorial. I will just go through some of other tools, some of the different panels, some of the different options, so that you can easily get started with this software. So without any further delay, let's get started. So I have my Affinity Designer opened, and before I move forward, I would like to clarify here is that I'm only going to explain most of the things briefly, because this software can be used for a variety of purposes. It can be used for vector creation, vector illustration. It can be used for digital painters to create digital paintings, and it can also be used for UI designers, maybe those people who design user interfaces. So I'll not be covering each and everything, but I will be covering those parts which are going to affect the vector illustrators, or you can say the vector illustration creators, those who wants to design their own t-shirts or any other kind of print on demand products. So basically it will be focused on vector creation and vector side of this software. So keep that in mind. So this is what you might see when you open up this software. I might have adjusted some windows here and there, but that's okay. I will explain in most of these panels and most of these windows later on in this tutorial. So this is what you see when you first open up this piece of software. At the top you have this designer persona, at the top left corner designer persona, then there is a pixel persona, and then there is the third one, that is export persona. Now the vector illustration or the vector artwork is mostly created in the designer persona. The pixel persona is mostly used by digital painters, or you, if you want to apply any kind of pixel based you can say effects, pixel based kind of any kind of thing, drawing thing, you will have to go into the pixel persona, and I'll explain it briefly later on. And then there is an export persona. In export persona, you are simply going to export your artwork and into different file formats. That's it. So at the top you have file option, and then there are different personas and all that. And then let's get started with creating a new document. So there is we have the option to create a new document or new from clipboard. Clipboard means if you have already selected any kind of artwork, maybe you have something copied, and it will create if you have maybe taken a screenshot of your screen, so it will keep that new dimensions of that into consideration. But let's not focus on that. So let's focus on this creating a new document. So once you click that new document window will open, and you will be able to select your document size based on the already pre-made presets that they have for photo, for web, for devices and all that. And I'm not going to cover that. I'm just going to focus on this thing, that if you are have to manually, you can say put your document requirement sizes that you want. So the page width and the page height is really simple. And then there is a dpi mention, that is 300 dpi, 200 dpi, depending upon what you want. If you are going to use it for print or maybe for print on demand purpose, you should use 300 dpi. And then there are document uses. It totally depends upon your you can say the choice, what you would like to use the units for this document. Then there is orientation. Orientation will automatically determine when you select the size. So if I change this to horizontal, you can see that the page width and page height size are inverted. So this is automatically changed. And then there is an option to create an artboard. If you are going to create multiple copies, it is mostly used for the UI designers. So let's not focus on that. Let's go move on to the color. For most of the cases, you are going to use these RGB colors. And if you are going to maybe print some kind of brochures or something like that, you might want to use the CMYK color. And then there is an option to choose the type of background, which is transparent background or the the default background, that is going to be white background. So let's keep it unchecked, because we can change it later on. and then there is option for margins. We usually do not need any kind of margin requirements when we are creating illustrations, so let's uncheck that. We do not need any margin, neither we need any kind of bleed. So let's get press create, and we are going to, and it has created a new document. And still after creating the new document, you can still go to this document, and in at the top left here, document setup, and you can change these sizes and scale them up. And in scaling them up, then there is an option here that is the objects will rescale. If you scale the document up, the objects will rescale proportionally. And then there are two options to, you know, scale, rescale option, anchor to the page. Okay, the second option here is anchor to the page, means once you scale the objects, actually when you scale the your document size, your objects, your illustration, everything will keep its original size, it will not rescale. So if you usually want to, you know, rescale it, so just keep it at rescale. And then there are color options. Again, let's check this transparent background. Let me show you. So after checking this transparent background, you will be able to see this checkered background here, which means that it has now has a transparent background. And it is highly recommended to use this when you are going to export your artwork in kind of in the form of a PNG image, to get the transparent background in the PNG image. If you have this option unchecked and you have this white background, and if you export it after creating any kind of illustration, anything, you will not get a transparent background. So that is something that you have to keep in mind. Then again, there is margins bleed option, which we have just gone through, we don't want it. So let's press okay. So let's now move to the different let's move to these preferences. Preferences are generally these different options, which I will go might go into different options later on when I'm going to explain some of the tools. So on the left side here, you have this tools panel, and I'm going to go through most of these tools one by one so that you can understand what each and every tool does. So the first and the top one is the move tool, or the black arrow tool it is called. It is going to, you know, to be used to move the objects around. So let's just create a simple object. Let's create a rectangle here, and let's select the black arrow tool. So we're using the black arrow tool, we are going to move the objects around in our, you know, document. So that's what it is used for. It is simple option, and it's that simple. Now again, if you have any, you know, more than one objects, let's create a new, maybe circle, change its color. I'll go through the option of colors later on. So maybe this one, maybe create another square here, and let's move it here. So another thing you need to keep in mind about the move tool is that if you have nothing selected in the layers panel here, and if you click on any object, it will be selected, or if you just drag and drop any object. So notice here that once I this drag I just pass through the boundary of the first object, it is highlighted in blue. So there is a blue boundary around it, means that that object is selected. Now this square, gray square, is selected only, not this one. Now if I drag it here again, and if I, you know, move it here, and if I leave it, now this small square and that gray square is selected, not this circle. It is because that now our actually this black arrow tool or the move tool is not considering this one as something that we want to be selected, because we are not covering this whole thing. If we are, you know, just covering it partially, it will not get selected. Nothing will get selected, as you can see here. If you want to change it, you need to go to the preferences, and in I think in the general, or maybe let's see, there is an option here. I think we need to go to the preferences of tools, and then here at the top, the select objects when intersects with selection marquee. So if we have this option checked, and now if we, you know, create a selection, even if it doesn't cover the whole object or, you know, shape, it will still be get selected here like this. So if you want it like that, you can keep that options checked. Okay, now let's move to the second tool, that is this artboard tool. As I already said, artboard tools are going to be used, artboards are going to be used for the user interface designers, so we'll not cover that. And then there is a node tool, actually. So node tool is something that is going to be used to change the points of any points or something like that. So before I go into explain the node tool, let me show you the difference between a pre-made shape, as they have already shown here in these tool manuals available here. The square, circle, and then there are other different shapes here as well. So let me explain the difference between the pre-made shapes and the curves that they have. These other shapes that the affinity, these people call it curve. So let's use this pen tool here, and let's create random shape here, and let's fill it with something maybe red here. So let's what's the difference between a pre-made shape and a curve? So this square and is a pre-made shape, while this abstract shape is not a pre-made shape, it is a curve, which means that I can go into this node tool and move any of the points here, and I can move the handles around and change the shape. But if I select this rectangle tool, I cannot do that thing. I cannot move these corner points independently. If I move it, it only going to scale down and scale it up. That's only it is going to do. So that's the difference between the pre-made shape and the curves. Means that in curves you can control each and every point, anchor point, they call it nodes. So you can control each and everything in the curve shape. Now what if you want to control the maybe anchor points or the nodes of any kind of pre-made shape? For that you have to convert it into a curve. So at the top you will have this option, is that convert to curve. As soon as you click it, now it is converted into curves. Now we can use this node tool and move any points around here. Now let's say if you want to maybe add another point to this thing, so simply you just click any area between the two points, anywhere on the line, and click here, and it will add a point. And you can see that I have mentioned it. I can easily move it. I can reshape it. Let's add a point here and move it here like that. Now what if you want to delete a point? You might have accidentally created it. So let's you just have to go to the select that point using that node tool, and then press delete, and it will be deleted. Now again, let's just clean it up, these shapes. Let's create some shapes because I want to show another thing here. Now again, you will be able to see that there is a small arrow here, and if you click here you will get another option here in addition to the node tool, that is the point transform tool. So what does this point transform tool does? So let me show you what does this node tool does, so that you can easily understand the difference. So if I select this curve, and if I move this point, I can easily move this point independently. Now if I go into this arrow and select this point transform tool, it means that it has this additional shape available here, that small thing here. Now what it does is that if I move the point around, now it rotates the objects around that thing. Now it scales down to that anchor point. It serves as an anchor point. Now it scales down to that anchor point and moves around here. Now here I can easily move that anchor point maybe here, because I want to scale it at this point. It will scale it to that area, and then it can easily rotate it. So this is the difference between the node tool and then point transform tool. So let's the next tool in the tools panel is the pen tool, which is the most usually tool when you are going to create illustrations. So let's just delete this curve layer. So this pen tool, you can use it to create anything that you want, any shape, anything. And let's go to the options available at the top for this pen tool. The first one is this, you can see that first option is available, and that is the pen mode. It simply means that you can click, if you click once, it will start creating the shape. If you click and drag, it will create a smooth area. If you click and drag again, it will create a smooth area. Now if you just click once, it will create corners in that area. And as soon as you reach the basically the first point, it will just close the shape. and you can easily then change the colors as you like. So this is the first option. Let's go to the second option, that is the smart mode. So if you have this smart mode checked, and you can, you know, simply, let me undo it, you can simply click, you don't have to drag it, it will automatically make any points into curve points. And this is useful if you want to, you know, use let the software calculate the curve values. So this is useful in those cases. Now let's delete it and let's focus on the third option. The third option is only going to give you the perfect corners of any object, any shape. So if I click here and then click and drag, it doesn't change anything. It is going to change the position of that node. It is not going to convert it into a smooth line or smooth point. So that is what this third option does. And the fourth option again is going to give you simple random line, simple lines. If I just click on one, click on the second point, it will give me a 1 point. If I, you know, want to go back and create a triangle, I cannot do that because it is only going to give me straight lines. So this is what it is used for. Next option here is this preserve selection when creating new curves. To be honest, I simply do not know what this does, but I do not do know what these other options are. So let me create this thing, and let me create a basic shape here. Actually selected the line, let me select the first option. So this is the first option that I've selected. Now if I close it, you can see that in the layers panel I have a one curve shape created. Now if I go back and start creating something new, you can see that a new layer is created and a new curve is created. If I go back and create something else, it will turn it in, create a new layer and a new shape. So this is what it normally does, this pen tool. And now if I have the other option selected, this one option, that is the add new curve to the selected curves, if I have this selected, now if I create any kind of shape and close it, now if I'm going to create any shape anywhere, anywhere, it does not create any new layer and doesn't create any new curve. It will create inside this already created curve. No matter how many shapes I create, it will still create it inside this curve. And when I move it, the whole thing is moved in collectively. So this is what that option does. Now again, the last option here is this rubber band mode. So in rubber band mode is that, let me show you if you draw it without this option. So you can see if I just start drawing, I can create different shapes. But if I have just want to create some shape here, I do not know how it will look like. I just have to guess it. Maybe this, once I click it, it will start creating shape and I can move it. But as soon as I want to click here, I do not know how it will look like. So if you have this rubber band option selected, let me select that. Now you can get a kind of a preview what your shape might look like if you click at any place. Maybe I click here, it will give me a preview of what my shape will look like. So as soon as I click and drag, it has created that shape. Again, it will give me a preview. So it is very helpful if you want to know what your shape might look like by clicking at certain points and the certain positions. So that's what this option does. So I think I have covered the pen tool. Let's see if there are anything else options. Snapping, that is a separate thing. We don't want to go into that. That is a separate whole different snapping tutorial, because this is the basic tutorial, this is a basic guide. So let's stick to the basics. Next is the pencil tool. Pencil tool is only going to create some kind of one pixel based layers, one pixel based lines. It is not going to give you anything. It is it will be helpful in creating kind of sketches and all that, and that's what it is mostly useful in these cases. So let's now move to the next tool, that is the brush tool, vector brush tool. Now it is again the second most used, I would not say the second most used, but the most helpful tool in this software. So if I select the brush tool, I will have to go and go to the brushes panel, and that is at the top here. If I click here, I can select different brushes, I can select different type of brushes that are available here. So let's go to the engraving brushes and let's select this one. So as soon as I start dragging, it is going to create a piece of brush, you can say the pre-made brush, that the pre-made shape, the pre-made artwork into these lines and lines. And I can change the width up here, and if you want to increase it, you can easily increase it. And the best thing is that it is completely editable. So if I go to the node tool and start moving these nodes around, the whole shape of the brush actually changes. So this is what the vector brush is is used for, to creating some kind of effect, pre-made kind of effect. So this is what it is. Again, the next option here is the in the brushes panel is this you can say window mode or stability mode. Let's not go through that. Let's go to the more options that is going to be useful. Now I can change the brush width here. I can change the size variance. Size variance means that if you are using any kind of graphic tablet, for example the Wacom tablet, the size variance is going to help you in that case. It will be use that pressure, pen pressure, and as it is mentioned here, it is going to use the pen pressure and different modes of pen pressure that are useful. So that is kind of advanced. So let's just skip that, and if you can stick to the basics. Let's select all of these and let's select delete. So in the brushes, that's how you create the brushes. And if you want to control the pen pressure, you can control it using the pen pressure. If you press harder, it will create a different effect. So I might create a separate video if you would like on brushes later on. So next option is this fill tool. Let's hide this brush panel, and next option is fill. Fill tool is going to help you fill different shapes and all that. Let's create a basic shape, maybe here, and let's close it. And if I use the fill tool, I can easily fill this shape while remaining in this pen tool. So I can fill it with any kind of color. It gives me this triad shape color wheel. If I don't want it into a form of color wheel, I can go into different slider options, for example HSL sliders, which I mostly used, and for changing the colors. And also you can go back to the color wheel, that is this with that is option HSL color wheel. So that totally depends upon what you would like, how you would like to do it, change the colors. Then the next option is the gradient option. The gradient option, which simply means that it will create a gradient, and you can change the colors of any kind of any nodes and all that if you like to change it. And if you want to add an additional point, you simply click inside this gradient and it will create an additional point here, and you can change its color as you like. Okay, then there are different gradient types. Elliptical means it will create an elliptical gradient, and that's what it is. But that is mostly useful when you are going to change the colors using that this tool that is called the fill tool. So let's go to the fill tool, and now you can see that in elliptical gradient form, I can change the position of the center area, and I can move these handles to change the look of this gradient. And if this option that is called the maintain fill aspect ratio is checked, so it means that both of these handles are actually moving in proportion to each other. So if I have this unchecked, I can move one handle and create a different look of the gradient. I can move the other handle independently, and this is what this option does. Again, and it is going to rotate the gradient, reverse the gradient, and this is these options, and that is what it does. Okay, now another option this fill tool can does is that in addition to these gradient types, you have solid color, linear gradient, elliptical gradient, radial gradient, conical gradient, and then that there is option that is called the bitmap option. So if you select that bitmap option, it will open up a new window where you will be able to select an image that is a PNG image, JPEG image, and it will fill that shape with that image. So let me show you by selecting an image using that bitmap option. So after selecting that bitmap option, that image is loaded, and you can scale it up and down. And let me check this option, maintain aspect ratio. So it is going to, you know, maintain the aspect ratio, and you can fill it with any kind of pattern, fill it with any kind of image that you might have. And that option is available here, that is wrap, mirror, and repeat. These are different options. These are kind of advanced. If you want me to go into that, I'll go into the fill tool in detail later on. So let's go to the transparency tool. Let's just change it to the gradient, maybe simple linear gradient, and change the gradient color here, and maybe this one, and then this lighter gray color, let's change it to this one. You know, I can, you know, adjust the position as the angle of that gradient. So then there is the transparency tool. Transparency tool simply means that it can make your object kind of transparent. So let's go into that transparency tool. At the top there is selected none, and we want to, let's say we want to create kind of, you know, linear gradient, linear transparency. So as soon as I click it and I select that option, this option here, I can select the transparency of this area. I can increase the opacity, as you can see it changing in the document here. I can increase the opacity, I can decrease the opacity as I will like, and I can even change the position of this thing how I would like to affect the how I like to make it transparent here. And this is what this transparency tool, and it is very helpful if you are creating kind of blends of colors and all that. So this is what transparency tool does. Then there is the place image tool. It means that if you want to place a simple JPEG image, any kind of image inside this document for maybe a reference to, maybe, you know, just want to select colors from that image, so you can use that. Then the next is the vector crop tool. Vector crop tool simply, you know, just crops that area, and it will hide it. It will, you know, create a mask, and that is separating. I will go into the mask and clipping paths into later on. Okay, then you have different shapes options available: rectangular, circular, rounded areas, and all that. Now, as I've already shown you the difference between a shape, a pre-made shape, and you know, a curve shape, let me explain it more in detail. So I'll select any kind of shape here, maybe, you know, just select the star tool, star shape, and create a star. If you you know, drag it here, you can, you know, make star of any shape. But if you press the shift key, it will keep the proportions and it will make the shape perfect. So let's just delete the previous one and let's scale it up. Now you have the star shape created. Now keep in mind that these shapes are actually the pre-made shape, these are not curves. So which means that you can have control over certain you can say the values, certain features of these shapes. So that is at the top point. So now we can change the points, how many points we want in a particular shape. Each and every shape will have different options. So in this option we have these options for the points. We can have the option to have these curved edges, and inner radius, it means that we can change this radius accordingly. And if we want to change the curves of these things, we can adjust the curves and angles of these things. So this is what this is how these shapes are actually useful, because they are going to give you different options. And if you don't have to go into, you know, detail into creating complex shapes, you can use pre-made shapes and start creating it. As you can easily see that you have control over a lot of different features, and each and every shape have different options available. For example, I create a square, I can adjust the corners and edges, boundaries. If I can make it round, I can make it like this, I can change it a position. And that is, these options are available as long as you have these shapes in the pre-made shapes. You can say style in the pre-made shape styles. As soon as you go and convert it into curved shape, you no longer have the option to, you know, the option to change these features of this shape. So keep that in mind. Okay, next we have this text tool, and we have two text style of options available. That is the artistic text tool and the frame text tool. The artistic text tool means that if you type here, let's not the word type, you can scale it up, you can type, change the font and everything. Then the whole typography thing in this Affinity Designer is a separate topic. I will not go into detail in each and everything, just the basic difference between the artistic text tool and the frame text tool. So I can do it, I can change its color, I can apply gradients and every different things. You can say, let's say apply the gradient, maybe change its color to the red, and maybe change that color to the maybe this color. So this is what artistic text tool does. The whole text still editable, I can go to the editor tool and I can make it change the type, it will keep the style, it will take keep the colors and all that. But if you have this options text frame tool selected, now if you click here, you have to drag it to create text frame. Now if you type it anything, now we have created a text, and now if you scale it down and scale it up, it does not affect the size of the text. It will just create it in the form of just a box filled with text. You can still change the you can say the size of the font, but by scaling it up and down, it is not going to give you any kind of effect like that. You can still change the gradient, but that gradient will be applied on the whole box inside anything that any text that you put it inside that. So this is something that you have to keep in mind. You have limited control over text box as compared to the artistic text. I've already gone into detail of this artistic text in one of my previous videos. I'll put the link in the card above, so make sure that you check that out as well. Then there is a color picker tool. So let's delete this text tool. Color picker tool simply means that you can create any shape, and let's create another shape, and let's fill it with simple this color. A color picker tool is going to help you pick colors from any other color. So let's pick this blue color, and we'll select fill this new shape, selected shape, with the new color, and it is going to help you just pick colors, simply is that. Then the next tool is this hand tool is just going to position your board, or you can say the document around in the view. That is what it is used for. Then there is the zoom tool. So if I click on any area and drag upward, it will zoom in, and if it drag down, it will zoom up, horizontally and vertically. This is what it does, like that. So this is the zoom tool. And if you are using creating shapes and all that, you don't have to go to the zoom tool each and every time. And there is a shortcut, you can press control and that wheel of your mouse in and out, and it will just zoom in and out. And that is a handy kind of, a shortcut to keep in mind. And that I think I have covered all of these tools, and now let's go to the other to the panels that are available here. Let's create a basic shape. Okay, the first panel here is the assets panel. That is going to be helpful if you have pre-made shape or actually pre-made artwork available in the form of assets. You can simply drag and drop them here and work on that. Then there is the appearance panel. The appearance panel is going to be helpful when you are creating multiple strokes, multiple fill types, and let's create another stroke here, and let's make this stroke a lot thicker, and maybe change its color to red, and as the stroke is a lot thicker and it is above that, let's bring it behind it. Let's change the first stroke to maybe thinner stroke, and let's change the color of that stroke to maybe red. So let's make it blue. So you can see that you can create multiple strokes on your shape and all that, multiple fills on your area, and using the blend option and all that in this appearance panel. That is kind of a bit more detailed. I might go into detail later on if you want me to do that. So let's clear that. Now let's come to the towards the right side panels available. The first panel is the layer panel. As we already guessed that, it will simply create layers on each and every shape that you create. It will create layers. And then there is effects panel. Effects panel means that it is going to create some kind of effects on your document, and you can create a shadow here, drop shadow, and change the offset, change the opacity of that shape. So this is useful in those cases. Then there are pre-made styles panel, that are these options. You can also create your own styles, but if you want to fill this shape with any kind of pre-made style, you can simply click it and it will apply that style on this shape that you have just selected. Okay, then there is the next textile options that is useful in typography. Then the next option is the stock option. If you want to search online for some kind of images, you will be able to use that option. Let's search for, I understand that, term ignition. Let's select for maybe a red flower. Now it will populate this area with red flowers. I can simply drag and drop, and inside you can say that Affinity Designer, and it will just populate it with this image that I have selected. So it is useful in those cases when you want to select different images and populate your document with different kind of images. So that is useful in those cases. And if I go back into layer panel, it will be simply available here for me to edit it. Okay, now above that there will be a color option. This is the same color wheel that I have already shown you. You can change the colors of your selected objects. But keep the let's focus here at the top here in this option. Now it has two kind of circles, the donut and a circle available, and there is this third small circle here. Now whatever selected here, I have this top color selected, a top circle selected. Now if I make any kind of change to the color, it will change the fill type. Let's hide select this square instead. Now if I change color, it will change the fill color. Now if I select this behind the circle, or you can say the ring behind it, now it is at the top. Now if you want to change the color, it is going to change the stroke color, as you can notice here inside the document. Now if you want to remove the stroke or maybe fill off anything, I'll just select this option, that is this small circle with the red line. If I select it, our stroke is gone. So that is useful in that cases. So if then there is this option, that is the color picker option. So let me just bring back one of these images here, and let me select this, place it here, and let me show you the option how helpful it is for you to pick color from any kind of image. So I have this image open, and if I want to select color from it, I can go to this color picker, and instead of clicking this color picker itself, I can go back and I have to click this small circle and then drag it. Then I can choose the color as I want. I might want to maybe choose this yellowish color. It will select that color and load it into the color picker. Now if we want to apply it to anything I want, I have to click it again, and let me show you. Let me select this fill color, and I have to drag that circle, and I can drag it onto anything. It doesn't have to be something loaded into the document. You can simply drag it and pick colors from the inside this panel as well, as you would like. Let me select this maybe a green color option, and it is loaded into the color picker, and once I click here, it's automatically filled that shape in here. So that is helpful in those cases when you want to change the color and pick the colors in those cases as well. And you don't have to pick it from the inside the software as well. You can still pick it off the site, or from your desktop, from your web browser, from anywhere, and it will simply work in that way as well. Then you have the option of swatches. Now swatches option is really helpful. Let me delete this image, and let me delete this shape as well. let me zoom out a bit. So let's select an image here, maybe select this image, because it has different colors available here. So I have this image selected, and let it load. I think it's a heavy image. Okay, now the image is loaded. Let me just scale it down. Okay, now if I like the colors of any particular image, let me open up the swatches panel and hide this top panel. So if I want the colors from any particular image, I can simply select colors from that. I can create a palette from that, and for that you have to go to this upper option, that is these bars option. If I select here and if I go to this create let's here the option available here, add document palette, means that it will select the colors from this particular image, particular selection, and it will add the palette inside this document. If you click the option add application palette, it means that if you create a palette, and that palette will be available for any kind of new document that you create inside this Affinity Designer. So let's create a document palette. It has created a new document palette. Okay, let's create a palette from this particular document, and it will create palette from document as a document palette, and it will choose the colors from this panel, this image, this selection from this document, and it will create a palette for you. So you can simply delete this shape. You can create any kind of new shape. Let's just decrease this stroke size and change color to black. Now if I want to fill it with anything, I may need to make sure what options are available. We have this fill option available, so I can select any color, and I can fill it with anything I want, any of these colors. If I want to change the stroke color, I have to select the stroke, and I can change the stroke color to anything I like. Let me show it clearly by increasing the stroke width. So that's how easy it is that you can create the palettes from any kind of image, from anything that you like. Now let's go to the layers panel, because this is something interesting that I would like to show you. So let's say I have this shape created, and let's change the color maybe of this stroke. Let's maybe do not select any kind of stroke. So I have this shape created, and the circle shape created, and let's change its color to maybe yellowish, something like that. Now you can see that our circles and our shapes are created as inside this, and they appear in this layers panel as layers. Now let me show you an interesting thing. Now if I move this yellow circle behind and this layer, I can move it and rearrange it as well. Now if I move it, and as soon as you notice it, it is intersecting this shape, the rectangle shape, because if I notice in the layers panel, if I move it at the top, you can see that a blue bar appears that is going all the way across this panel completely. But if I move it inside this, want to move it inside this rectangle, and the blue bar only goes from this icon to the edge, right edge. It doesn't go all the way to the this left side. So if I release it here, it has kind of created a clipping mask, means that in the circle that I've created is inside it, and I can move it, and it will only appear inside this upper shape. That is helpful in creating clipping marks. Let me move it behind this shape, and let me show you another thing. Now it has created a clipping mask here. Now if I move this circle and place it over here, and inside of below this rectangle, I move it right next to this icon. Now what it does is that inside of creating a clipping mask, it creates a mask, which means that now I can I can simply just, of course, I can move it this circle around here, But now you can see that now instead of the circle being visible, now the intersection is visible, a kind of crop is being created. So in this upper area, the rectangular shape, I can increase the shape of that crop area, and inside this circle I can move it and I can increase and decrease the shape of that area. Now let me delete it and let me briefly show you the pixel persona, and that is the upper right here in this area. So let me just select create this shape, this rectangular shape. Let me use a gradient for that purpose, and let me change its color to this, and I can change the position of the gradient or the look of the gradient using the fill tool. And I might want to move it here like that, create something like that here. And let me now let's go to the pixel persona. Now what pixel persona does is that it is going to create some kind of pixel effects on that. And let me show you one of the example. Let me show you this paintbrush tool, and in the brushes option, now these brushes are not the same brushes as a vector brushes. These are the pixel based brushes. And let me select any kind of other option. Let me select these maybe spray and splatters. So this option available here. Let me increase the size of this brush a little bit. Let me change the color of that brush to maybe black, slightly grayish color, like something like that. Now if I paint that brush over here, you can see, let me increase the size even further so you can easily, let me close it, you can easily see that. Let me increase the size a lot, like maybe 2000 pixel and like that. Now as soon as I create a brush here, fills that area with that color that I've selected. And in addition to that, it is created a mask, the clipping path of that brush. So if I release it here and bring it to the top, you can see that it's going beyond the edges. Now if I just create a parent, a child of that area, I can make it, and I can say that create interesting effects in this way. I can change the option from normal to darken, and change the opacity of that to have that kind of darkish shadowy type of effect like that. And in addition to that, if I create a new layer here inside that and change the color to maybe slightly whitish, yellowish, whitish thing, I can go to the brush and make it another different type of effect that I like here, and maybe change its from blend mode to screen, maybe opacity change in that. So you can see that in addition to your vector drawing, vector shapes, inside this pixel persona you can have some kind of organic feel to your vector drawings, vector shapes and vector artwork. And I have gone into detail, a little bit detail of creating an illustration using this pixel illustration, pixel persona and the vector persona, actually the designer persona, they call it designer persona, I think. That's what it's called. Yes, it's called as design persona. So I have gone into detail. I'll put the link for that video in the card box, so make sure that you check that out as well. So hopefully I have covered all of these basics for you. If you have any question, if you have any confusion regarding any of that, you can ask me in the comments below, and I'll try my best to answer those questions. If you have found this video to be helpful, to be useful, make sure that you like the video and subscribe, and don't forget to press that bell icon so that you can be notified about my future videos as well. And thank you for watching.